Can you see the PPT?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the name of the experiment is a study of DC servo motor characteristics. So there are few keywords associated with this experiment, name of the experiment, that is DC, first of all study, number two DC, then servo, then motor, then characteristics. So we are basically trying to study the characteristics. That means the electrical characteristics, electrical and electromechanical characteristics. Electrical and electromechanical characteristics. That means electrical characteristics like the armature current, armature voltage and armature current, also the speed, torque, this type of characteristics of a DC servo motor. Now, why we are so curious to know about the characteristics of DC servo motor? You have already studied full-fledged papers on a DC machine and their characteristics, speed, torque, and other characteristics. So what is special in DC servo motor that we are trying to get its characteristics or study its characteristics? The thing is, servo motor is a special kind of DC motor. You will find it, this type of DC motors in machine tool application, in precision, that means in precision movement, in precision motion control applications, in industry, in academics, and many places now where you need to control the motion very precisely employing some standard control algorithm or advanced control algorithms. So what is special in these? The applications are okay. After this statement, you understood that the application are quite large number of applications is expected in industry, in machine tool application, in robotics, this healthcare sector also. You'll find in various types of machinery for testing, where the movement or motion to be controlled precisely. See, in a controlled motion, there are two aspects associated with the motion control. One is the precision of the motion control. That means the steady state error. The steady state error should be least or minimum. So that implies a precision in the control. So how much degree in angular motion, how much degree you wanted to move, and actually what amount the machine got moved. So you need to know whether the command, the motion command you are applying, and the controlled motion, that means the of course in feedback control, the controlled motion, the motion output, whether they match, or you can say whether the control system perfectly tracks the reference. Whether the motion control system perfectly tracks the reference given. So that is one aspect. That means the perfect or a very accurate motion control is required. And DC servo motor finds application in those cases. And number two, the speed of operation. Being a control system element, that means the actuator or final control element of a feedback control system, the DC servo motor is expected to operate very fast. That means its dynamic characteristics. Its dynamic characteristics should be fast. In system theory, you studied the modeling, that means finding transfer function of a DC servo motor from the very, very basic understanding of physics. And you found that there are two time constants of a DC servo motor. One is mechanical time constant, another one is electrical time constant. And that's why it's a second order system. So there are two time constants, that means there are two poles and it's a second order system. Now you found that the electrical time constant is very small, so compared to the mechanical time constant. So you neglected electrical time constant and you approximated a DC servo motor as a first order system. We will verify this aspect at the end of this experiment first. So the time, if I consider it's a second order system, ideally second order system. So being a fast, if I claim that the DC servo motor is a very fast acting, or its dynamic characteristics are fast, what does that mean? That means its rise time is small. And if I want that the motor should settle down very quickly, then we will expect that its percent overshoot should be small. Like that, the time domain specifications of a second order system should be made. So what I wanted to convey that it should have a DC servo motor being a control system element, it should have good dynamic characteristics and good steady state characteristics. How can we achieve that dynamic characteristics and steady state characteristics? From the very common engineering sense, so common sense and engineering sense, if I combine them together, so it's a very common engineering sense, not specific to any branch of engineering, but it may be common to all branches of engineering. So basic engineering common sense, we can say that okay, nobody is there. The inertia of the system, inertia of the rotor of the DC servo motor should be kept small so that the mechanical time constant can be reduced. If I reduce the mechanical time constant of a DC servo motor, then what will happen? It's mechanical, if I keep the inertia small, then its mechanical time constant will be less. So it will be responding very fast to the control input, to the control action. The motor will respond fast, number one. And regarding electrical time constant, we have already neglected it because its value is quite small. So mainly the time constant is contributed by its mechanical design, mechanical aspect. Okay, so one is inertia, moment of inertia. So you have to reduce the moment of inertia of a DC servo motor. So compared to the commercially available DC motor. So DC servo motor has less inertia of the same rating DC motor, commercially available DC motor. So how can we achieve that? I'm going to discuss it. Next, in order to reduce the steady state error, that means in order to increase the accuracy of the closed loop motion control system, where DC servo motor is being employed, we expect that the motor should operate in a linear manner, because you have already studied in your control theory books that due to the presence of non-linearities, the steady state error arises. Okay, the non-linearities present in the system contributes to steady state error. Apart from the system type contributes to steady state error, and over and above, non-linearities also plays a big role in steady state error. So we want that DC servo motor should be such a DC motor where the moment of inertia is less and its characteristics are linear. Now, how to reduce the moment of inertia? the easy way to reduce the moment of inertia is while is to reduce the diameter of the moving part, that means the rotor. Reduce the diameter of the moving part, that means the rotor, okay, or armature. Here the armature is placed on the rotor and field is placed in the stator. So armature diameter should be reduced during the design to keep moment of inertia small. But if you reduce the diameter, what happens? As per the basic law of mechanical engineering, the power output of any rotating machine is proportional to the square of diameter. So if you reduce the diameter, the yield effect will be, the power output will get reduced. I'm not going to allow anybody after this person. So I was telling that power output is proportional to the square of diameter. So if you reduce the diameter in order to reduce the moment of inertia, what will happen? The power output will also get reduced. Now, in order to compensate that, what we can do? Now, power output, mechanical power output also proportional to the square of the length of the rotating machine. So in order to compensate the reduction in power output, we, during the design for DC servo motor, we increase the armature length. So for the same power rating, if you compare a DC servo motor with an ordinary DC motor or commercially available DC motor, you will find that the commercially available motors are having larger diameter than the DC servo motor and shorter armature length than the DC servo motor. So by inspection, you can say whether by comparing during inspection, but you can compare this by visual inspection, that if you find two motors of the same power rating, you can say that the motor which has less diameter, which is slimmer but longer, are DC servo motor. Okay, so this is the you can say the mechanical aspect. Now regarding, so this plays a big role in its fastness or speed of operation. Now why servo? What is there? So as I said, this type of motors are applied for tracking control application. Tracking control is also called servo control. The word servo originated from the word servant. So it obeys the master. That means that whatever command is given, servo motor obeys that. It follows that command. That's why it's servo motor. Now, these are the points I'm going to discuss. Servo system, this is a typical servo system. Now, servo system is a system which tracks the reference, okay? Tracks the reference and gives the motion accordingly. So this is a typical servo system where this table is being moved as per the motion command. It's a feedback control system, where control variable is the mechanical position or its derivatives. Okay, so all motion variables are controlled as per the command given. So it's a closed loop control system. Now, the block diagram is a very common, you have already seen. So servo motor is controlling some device. We are getting feedback. That means the motion variables are being measured and fed back and compared with the reference, and the error is generated, and error is then passed through some controller. Here the controller is not shown, but if any controller is not shown and the input is error, then you can say that proportional control of unity gain. So unity gain proportional control can be assumed over here. And that is the control output from the proportional or controller can be amplified, because the controller gives signal. It cannot give power supply. Okay, so we have to amplify that signal to a power level so that it can drive the motor. So amplifiers which give power supply to motor, servo motor, is also called servo amplifier or driver. In industry, it is called driver because it gives the driving capability, drive, power drive capability. And in control applications, it is called servo amplifier, the amplifier which gives amplified power. Okay, which gives amplified power to the servo motor is called servo amplifier. So servo motors can be applied for position control. This experiment we will perform in next in fourth year. So I'm not going to discuss this one right now. So this is the exaggerated diagram of the previous one. Sometimes noise gets penetrated through the feedback element. That means measurement noise. Feedback element is basically measuring element or sensor, and disturbance input may. It's also a kind of you can say it's a signal. Sometimes it's maybe a signal or sometimes maybe some variable, process variable. And I hope you know the difference between sensor and transducer. The feedback elements are not transducer. Some misconception is there. Feedback elements are transducer. No, it's a sensor. Feedback elements are sensors, not transducers. Transducer can only convert energy in one form to another, nothing more than that. But a sensor is an off-the-shelf element which can give you, ready measurement. Suppose you want to measure body temperature. So what will you do? Will you buy a thermistor or a thermometer? Obviously, you will buy a thermometer, not a thermistor, because from the basic principle, it's okay. It can convert heat to electricity, okay, energy, temperature to electric voltage. But in order to use that thermistor as a measuring element, you have to perform many operations. That means, first of all, you have to amplify because the signal, measuring signal available at the output of the transducers are very weak. You have to amplify that signal. You have to filter out noise. Then, if the characteristics of that transducer is nonlinear, you have to linearize it. Then, if you need some level shifting, that you have to do. And then all signal conditioning and signal processing should be done first. And then you have to calibrate the final condition, the calibrate it with respect to a reference. Then only it can be used as a sensor. So there is a big difference between a sensor and transducer. Maybe the heart of a sensor may be a transducer, but the total package, that means transducer along with signal conditioning elements plus its calibrated, okay, calibrated operation as a whole, it gives you a sensor. So it's a package. Sensor is a package. I hope you will not forget it. So in job interview, quite often this technical question is asked: what is the difference between sensor and transducer? So here in control system, we don't use the raw transducers. We use sensors. Remember. And we have to choose it accordingly, depending upon the variable. For example, if it's a motion variable over here, okay, it's in a servo system, then what will be the feedback element? If I want to control the speed, then the feedback element or the sensing element should be able to measure the speed or velocity of the shaft. If I want to control the position, then this feedback element should be able to measure the position. Okay, so depending upon the requirement, you have to choose the feedback element. So here in servo system, we use two types of sensors. One is speed sensor, another one is position sensor. The speed sensing is invariably done by TACO generator because of its accuracy and convenience. So construction wise, same as the DC motor, but as I said, that during the design, its diameter is kept small and length is increased in order to make its dynamic response faster. So this is explained over here. Another thing, least nonlinearity. How we can reduce the nonlinearity? See, there are few points where nonlinearity can enter into the system. One is the mechanical components. That means the bearing. The gear arrangement, if that is necessary. Bearing is always necessary. So because of the friction in the bearing, some non-linearity may get incorporated into the system because of the gearbox, presence of the gearbox. Because gearbox, you invariably find, you'll invariably find that gearbox has backlash. Backlash is a very hard non-linearity like that. So you have to reduce those mechanical, these non-linearities present in the mechanical systems. Regarding the electrical system, the iron core that is present, okay, iron core has hysteresis. So this plays a very big role in non-linearity, these hysteresis in the magnetic circuit. So you have to design the magnetic circuit with good quality magnetic material. Now this is the experimental setup. So DC servo motor is lying below this cover. So if you remove this cover, you will be able to see the DC servo motor, a very small one. So in the experimental setup, we have connected a metal disc, aluminium disc on the motor shaft. And the other end of the motor shaft is connected to a TACO generator. TACO generator shaft and motor shaft are connected by flexible shaft coupling, because the alignment of the DC motor shaft and the TACO generator shaft may not be perfect. So this misalignment may lead to vibration and other undesirable effect like unbalanced torque. Okay, so that may result into wear and tear of the bearing of both the motor as well as the TACO generator, mainly the TACO generator, because TACO generator is a very delicate device. It's a sensor. Sensing elements are always very delicate, so you have to handle them with care. Now the disc, the metal disc, aluminium disc, is allowed to freely rotate inside the magnetic field of this very powerful permanent magnets. There are two permanent magnets of U shape. I'll show you in the video how they look like. So what happens, the flux in this air gap, when the metal disc is fully placed inside this air gap, a good amount of flux will cut this metal disc. As a result, what will happen, eddy current will flow, and that eddy current will interact with this flux itself so that it produces a torque which opposes the cause, that means the rotation by the motor. Okay, so by allowing the disc to rotate inside the magnetic field, we are actually applying a mechanical load on the motor shaft. This is called eddy current brake. That's why this device or arrangement is called permanent magnet brake or eddy current brake. And this device is a potentiometer. By moving this knob, we can set the voltage, variable DC voltage. This is also one potentiometer, rotary potentiometer. And we have one, this comparator. This is also a potentiometer. This is a comparator, op amp based summing amplifier. And I think this one is the pre-amplifier. And this is servo amplifier. Servo amplifier takes power from the power supply, DC power supply, and it amplifies the control input. Okay, control input provided at its input terminal. It gives power amplification so that the armature current, sufficient armature current, can flow inside the armature circuit and torque is produced. This motor, DC servo motor, is a permanent magnet type. That means the field is a permanent magnet, a pair of permanent magnets. And the power, the armature current, as it is in series, so the amount of armature current can be measured in the meter connected to the power supply. So this circuit diagram has a mistake over here. So this connection should have a jumper at this place and should be connected here. This is the load, eddy current brake. This one is the TACO generator. This one is the DC servo motor, and this one is the summing amplifier. Now a set of data is given. This is useful for calculation. So a tachogenerator constant is given, 2.7 volt per 1000 RPM. The characteristics of the tachogenerator is linear. So its slope is constant. That means per 1000 RPM, the armature voltage at the tachogenerator, it's a DC generator, very precision DC generator. The voltage induced will be, voltage generated will be 2.7 volt. So if the speed is 500
Sir?
RPM, so the, yes?
Sir, someone is trying to enter in the lab.
Yes. I'm not going to allow anybody to admit. This is not the time to join.
Sir, he has some network issue, sir.
Deny entry. I'm helpless. This creates a disturbance in my teaching. So apart from this, 2.7 volt per 1000 RPM. So this is the this data will be required to measure the speed in RPM. So you just have to measure the tachogenerator output by a voltmeter or a multimeter. You have to measure, and if you get some voltage, say a V volt, you have to just divide that voltage measured by 2.7. So that will give you the RPM, exact RPM. Now the torque characteristics, you have to find out, you have to calculate the torque generated by the DC servo motor. So how to calculate that torque or measure that torque? Measuring the torque of any motor is not so easy. It's a quite complicated method. Earlier we used to measure the torque in the machine laboratory by some brake arrangement. You will learn it in due course, or some dynamometer. So for very small motors, these arrangements are very, you can say, cumbersome, not possible. So here we are using a table. Now we calibrated, we measured the characteristics beforehand, and as the motor is approximately linear, so we could use this table. So this experiment was carried out at 1000 RPM, and the brake position 2. So this brake has many positions, 2, 4, 6, up to 10. Okay. So at brake position 2, at 1000 RPM, the torque generated is 5 millinewton meter. At position 3, 23 millinewton meter, like that. At brake position 10, that at when the disc is fully occupying the air gap, fully entered in the air gap, then it is 160 millinewton meter. Now let us see some video. So this one is attenuator, or it's a potentiometer basically. This one is operational amplifier, we are using it as a summer. If you remove this cover, you will find this DC motor. This one is the metal disc, and this is the brake, magnetic brake. This is movable, fully occupied, now in fully occupied position. So it is calibrated as 0 to 10. So brake position 10 means it is the disc is, it's in, it is placed in such a position that the disc has fully entered into the air gap. So this is the servo amplifier, the circuit you can see. These are the inputs to the servo amplifier. One is normally grounded in the sub-amplifier input. Now, with one voltmeter, we measure the input voltage given. We measure the input, reference input. Now, this experiment will be performed in open loop. So the input or reference voltage we will measure with one voltmeter or with one multimeter in ammeter mode, we will measure the current being supplied to the motor, and with one multimeter we will measure the tacho generator voltage to measure the speed. Okay, these three parameters, three data sets will be used for further experiment. Now it is at brake position 5. We are changing the input voltage. We are seeing the armature current. Not yet started, so armature current was very small. Now it will start. We are going to increase. We are increasing the voltage. So this is the input voltage given. Now if you increase the voltage bit more, let me see. Yeah, now it is 0.4 volt. So the armature current will also go up 0.39 ampere. Sorry. So we are going to, we are increasing the input voltage. Armature current is also increasing. And tacho generator voltage is also changing. The speed is increasing, so tacho voltage also increasing. 2.7 corresponds to 1000, so it's 2.34, very close to 1000. So in this way, we will gradually change the input voltage by the input potentiometer and record the reading. So experimental data, this is just one example. I have taken these data sets from our repository in the laboratory. The experiment, this open loop experiment is performed in two modes. One is input voltage, that means the reference voltage 1 volt, another one for 2 volts. And keeping the input voltage at 1 volt, we are first keeping the brake position 10. Now we are going to reduce the brake position. So what will happen? Armature current will reduce. At brake position 10, maximum load torque is applied. So maximum armature current to overcome the load torque. And the speed is small, 1.18. Now we are going to reduce the brake position. So load torque is getting reduced. So armature current is reduced. But the speed is increasing. So see, the tacho generator voltage is increasing. Now these are the calculated from the table, as I have explained. Speed in RPM, this can be calculated from here, and speed in radian per second also calculated from this data, and or this data. Now the torque is calculated from that table that we have here. So for brake position 10, for 1000 RPM, this is the torque, but here the speed is how much? 437 RPM. So we have to scale it accordingly. So we could fill up this table. Similarly, for EI, 2 volt, same thing will be repeated. So as a result, what we'll get? We'll get speed torque characteristics. So here speed and torque, both are available. So we can plot the speed torque characteristics. The theoretical characteristics should be like this. So these are for input voltages, different input voltages. Okay, so the speed and torque, this graph, there's perfectly straight line because we have assumed it's a linear system, and their gradient, that means the slope, should be same, so they are parallel. But in actual case, we found that although they are straight lines, but the gradient is not same because of the slight amount of non-linearities present in the system, and also due to measurement error. So the same video, almost same video. I'm sir, not repeating it.
Hello, sir.
Yes, yes. Hello?
Tacho generator is transducer or the sensor? Sir, it should be the Which transducer, one? Na?
Which one?
Tacho generator.
Which one? Tacho generator. Yes, a good question. Why shall we say it a sensor here, not a transducer? Although it's just a generic one.
Energy.
Here we are using the
Energy conversion is here,
yes,
not
yes.
sir.
I'm explaining it to you.
Rotational energy.
I'm explaining it. I'm explaining it. I'm
okay,
explaining
sir.
It.
Okay, sir.
I'm explaining the doubt. Don't worry. Here, see. Not this video. I should take the help of. Oh, close the program. Just a moment. By the time the PowerPoint is opening, let me explain. See, the transducer. transducer is just converting the input energy to input energy in one form to energy in another form at the output. Now here the TACO generator, although apparently we can find that it is taking mechanical input and giving us electrical output, but see, before we could employ it in this application, control system application, we have calibrated it, and as we have calibrated it, we got the TACO generator constant. Although we are performing manual calculation, but we could be able to perform this manual calculation because we have already calibrated it. So this, although it's a transducer at the first instance, it appears to us as a transducer, but it is a calibrated transducer. That's why it's a sensor, not a transducer only. I hope you got my point. Any doubt?
Okay, sir. No doubt. Okay, sir.
Yeah. So transducers are just transducers. They are not calibrated. They don't care whether you calibrate it or not, whether you use it, condition its signal or not. Yet signal conditioning is not required because it's a linear device. So only calibration is enough. So you perform the calibration, the very, I think in the first year or second year itself. Now it's, I think it's carried out in first year. Calibration of voltmeter, ammeter. So that is very important, calibration, understanding calibration. Otherwise, all measurement will be vague. So now I have reopened the PowerPoint. I went up to this. Okay. Let me share the PPT once again. Can you see the PPT now?
Yes, sir.
Can you? Yeah, okay. So here what we do in this run, first we will allow the disk to rotate in the fully occupied condition, that occupied condition of the air gap. It's occupying the full air gap. So it's brake position 10. Okay, now we will change the brake position. Not very clear. Let me explain it using this data, experimental data. Then video is not clear. So what is done? So we will increase the input voltage. Sorry. No, no. We will not change the brake position. We will keep the system at a particular brake position, and we go on increasing the input voltage gradually. So what will happen? The current will also go on increasing. Input voltage is increasing, so the current will also increase to increase the speed. So this is carried out over here. Brake position, I think it's 8 or 9. We will increase the voltage from here, input port. So finally, so to cut short the process, so see, the input voltage we are gradually increasing, keeping eye on the ammeter. Keeping eye on the ammeter. Okay. So you cannot stop it. It's a continuous process, and you cannot go back. So first, you so this run should be performed carefully. Actually, the brake position is not written. That's why some confused. I got some bit confused. It's performed at a particular brake position. So you are increasing the input voltage. So the current is increasing to the maximum current, maximum allowable armature current. Then you reduce the input voltage. Okay, gradually, so that the current is also reduced. Now, if the system is a linear one, then the characteristics, speed torque characteristics, that will be available for this data set, and the speed torque characteristics that will be available for this data set should coincide. Because we have not changed any experimental setting, that means the load position. But what happens, they slightly deviate. The increasing and decreasing characteristics slightly deviates. And this is called hysteresis of the DC servo motor. It's called hysteresis of DC servo motor. Here one mistake is there, y-axis, x-axis. I discourage students that now you are quite mature. Okay, now you are third year, so this is not expected. So these x-axis, y-axis, it is for school students. Up to school, it's okay. But in engineering curriculum, there is no x-axis, no y-axis. This is a speed axis or input voltage axis, and this is a current axis or torque axis, like that. Or this is a speed and this is input voltage. So you can write like that, a horizontal axis or vertical axis. You can write no problem. Or you can write input voltage axis, speed axis, or current axis, like that. So don't write this kind of x-axis, y-axis. Completely nonsense. Those who still writes like that, they are doing the not the appropriate thing. Projecting yourself as a stupid like that. Don't this kind of stupid work. Leave it. Try to rectify yourself, even if you are writing like this fashion. So don't write x and y axis like this without giving any consideration of the actual axis. Okay, stop doing this from now onwards. Now, regarding the time response. Time response. This is a second order system. This is an underdamped response of an ideal second order system. Ideal, I'm saying that's a linear second order system, linear, single input, single output. Time invariant second order system shows this type of response. And these are the time response specifications. In the next run, we are going to capture the time response characteristics. As I said in the system theory, you already seen that the electrical time constant is negligible. Electrical time constant is negligible. So after neglecting the electrical time constant, you can approximate it as a first order system. See the time response. Time response. So what we do, we apply a step input of specific step input. Here it is showing as 3 volt. So note the response using a strip chart recorder at the TACO generator output. So this is the plot of TACO generator output, this upper plot with respect to time. And the lower one is the reference input. So although there is a bit, you can say, offset, but we can measure it, no problem. Whatever be the input and output, from the output response, we can say that these notches are due to noise and vibration, noise due to vibration or similar spurious input data. So if I neglect these noises, so I can say that the response approximately looks like a first order system, response of a step response of a first order system. So whatever we have learned from theory, in practice it is also the same. Now another thing we can get from this response is that we are approximating as a first order system. Okay, from the output response we can say that's a very much similar to a first order system. We are neglecting a time delay. So from here we can get the time time constant. This is 0 point or origin. If I consider this is the origin, from here I can draw a horizontal line, and in the vertical axis I can calculate the steady state. Also find out how much is the steady state value. So 63.2% of the steady state value, make a horizontal line over here. So, and then draw a vertical line from this point and this point, we can calculate the time, and that is the time constant. So we can find out the time constant very easily from here, isn't it? So, and input, we know the steady state value of the input and the steady state value of the output. From here, we can calculate the gain. So we have the gain, we have the time constant. So we can write down the approximate transfer function. Isn't it? So from this experiment, we can find out the model. We can identify the model of the TC servo motor also. So these are the references. You can go through it. This book, I hope you already studied, Nagarath and Gopal, and also a few web links I have given. You can go through them for more details, more technical details about TC servo motor. So I will share the PDF of this PPT with Bidipto through WhatsApp. Bidipto, please share it with your friends so that they can also go through it.
Okay, sir.
Now, regarding any doubt, you can ask me now or can send WhatsApp. Send your doubt to me by WhatsApp.
Hello, sir. Sir?
Yes.
How we calculate the numerical value of the torque? How we calculate the numerical value of the torque? Is it P is equal to tau?
Numerical value of what?
Torque. Mechanical torque.
Torque. Here I have calculated the torque using the table. This table. Okay. First of all, see, I have to look into the brake position. In which brake position? That means how much mechanical brake has been applied, and the because the torque generated by the DC servo motor is the torque it has to overcome, load torque it has to overcome. So how much load torque you have given at the state as at the equilibrium, it will generate the same amount of torque, isn't it? So that from that principle of conservation of energy. So say at brake position 9, I want to calculate the torque. So I have to first measure the speed. Okay. So at the brake position 9, if I find out that the speed is 700 RPM, so I have to proportionately find out the speed, because at 1000 rpm the torque is this much, 141 millinewton meter. So at say 700 rpm that you have noted at brake position 9, you can calculate that torque proportionately. So 141 divided by 1000 into 700, that is the case. In this way we will calculate the torque. Yes, theoretically you can calculate, provided you have all the design data, how much flux density is there, all these, how much current is flowing from there, also you can calculate. But in this experiment, because the manufacturer of the servo motor, they have performed the intensive testing in the lab, and they have given this data set table. The best one is to use a very mini or small dynamometer in this experimental setup. But as the motor is very small, that very small sized dynamometers are not available. That is the problem. But we can do it indirectly by some strain gauge type sensor we can use. Some elaborate arrangement is required for that. So for simplicity, but because the system is linear, more or less linear, we are using this table. Any other question?
Sir, how the brake position has changed when we perform the test?
Brake positions are changed manually. Brake positions are changed manually. See, the brake is mechanically coupled with this bracket, metallic bracket, and the bracket the bracket is actually connected to this stand. So it is held at a particular position by the friction present over here. So you can manually change the brake position. So while changing the brake position, you should be careful that the rotating disc should not foul with this permanent magnet. They are very, very powerful permanent magnets. And the air gap is small, so that the leakage of the flux is minimum. Most of the flux will cut this aluminium disc. So it is movable. Input voltage is provided by the potentiometer, these potentiometers. I was changing the potentiometer. Yeah, just by rotating the potentiometer, you can change the value of E. Any other doubt? So this experiment is a very nice experiment. It has relevance for industrial applications. In industry, you will find intensive or very huge application of servo motors. And if you know the characteristics of servo motors and various other technicalities associated with it, hope it will be helpful in your career, particularly those who will join in automation industry. In automation, you will find thousands of different sized servo motors.
Sir, বলছি input voltage কি একদম supplier voltage নাকি gain বাড়ানোর পর amplifier পরের voltage?
No. দেখো, এখানে একটা just one thing should be very clear. This experiment is performed in open loop. Although there are provisions for closing the loop, but we are not doing a closed loop operation. We are giving input voltage, that is EI. Input voltage is given by the potentiometer that I have already shown you. The potentiometer we are giving, its input voltage is fixed voltage is minus 15 to plus 15. Okay, but we are feeding it 0 to 15 volt DC. And if I rotate the movable position, then what will happen? This voltage will be divided to some lower value. So we adjust it to 1 volt and 2 volt just by adjusting the position of the movable contact.
Okay,
I hope you know the principle of potentiometer.
Yes, sir.
This is open loop operation. This experiment is done in open loop operation. Closed loop operation of servo motor will be performed in final year. One experiment will be done for speed control, another one for position control. Okay. So if you have any other doubts, so you can write to me through WhatsApp or email. I have to close this session now because I have another class to organize after 5 to 10 minutes.